Overtired.
Hello, everybody. This is Overtired. I am your host, Jeff Severance Gunsel. I'm one of your hosts. Our second of three hosts, Christina Warren, is in New York seeing Taylor Swift, which is, I don't know if there's a more perfect term than on brand, but if there is, then let's just imagine that I'm saying that word. And then it's Brett Terpstra.
Wait, I'm the third of three hosts. Even though Christina is gone, I'm still in third place.
I got excited about saying the Taylor Swift thing. It just, it's not nothing to do with preference or actual rank or hierarchy.
Since you came aboard, there has been significantly less Taylor Swift talk overall, which I personally don't mind. Like, it still comes up.
Yeah.
But there have been episodes of this podcast that have been all about Taylor Swift.
Right.
Longtime listeners will know that there's a reason that our tagline was Taylor Swift podcast.
Yeah, completely. Yeah. It'd be good. It'd be a good bit if we just dedicated one of these where it's you and me to Taylor Swift and I didn't say anything. We'd have to really work. I think we'd have to do some prep work, but I think we could pull it off.
to not say anything about Taylor Swift?
No, to only talk about Taylor Swift.
To only talk about Taylor
Swift. Only talk about Taylor Swift. Why can't I say her name?
Twaylor. Shania.
Yeah, see, Twaylor, I was Shania-ing it all together. I know they're very different. So here we are.
Here we are. Brett. How's your mental health, Jeff?
You know, I can talk about something that was just lovely for my overall professional mental health this last week. We're starting a new project at this research and evaluation co-op that I'm part of. We're starting a new project with a new client, and it's basically many months of designing an evaluation and then hoping maybe we get the contract to do the evaluation. So we'll see.
Okay.
It's an unusual contract for us. Anyway, it's one that is with a client that is sort of in the league that we have not previously engaged with. And so they do everything in a much more sort of orderly, professional way than most of our clients. Like, we have to use Microsoft Teams, which otherwise I've never had to use.
Sure.
And there are all these other things, like when you submit a budget, there's a template for it, which is not something we usually have to deal with. There are protocols, because this is such a large organization, that are unlike anything we've dealt with in the past. And we're super adaptable, but like, it's very new. So we decided we were going to hire a project manager, because in the past, how we've worked, we're like little rogue evaluation groups, you know, 2 to 5 of us. And we just kind of like make do with our combined skills. But we realized that this might be one where our combined skills and our combined personalities don't necessarily like meet the bar. And so we're like, and I've always wanted to work with a project manager. I think that's just like a fantastic idea if it's the right person, right? Project managers are like copy editors. Sometimes they're so obsessed with their own sort of toolbox that there's absolute rigidity and no fluidity or flexibility. Like, with copy editors, I've had experiences. Most of my experiences have been fantastic, because I love to be edited in any way possible. I just love people saying, no, do it this way, and then giving it a shot, right? But if it can't be like a conversation, then it's really tough. But anyway, I've had copy editors who, for instance, forget that there is a such thing as voice, right?
Yeah.
And so, we can do it all by the book, but then we lose the voice, whether it's mine or whoever we're editing. And with project managers, I've had the experience where it's like, okay, I come in with this tool and you all have to learn this tool. And like, that's the death of almost all project managers, right? Is when you try to force a tool. I would love to force a whole suite of tools
to
the teams I work with.
The death is when you force a tool and then change your mind.
Yeah, that's
true. And you're like, actually, now we're going to use Asana for everything.
Exactly, Asana. Yeah, I've been down that road, not voluntarily, but so anyway, we had to hire this person in like a week, so we had to like, get all the applications, do the interviews. We did 11 interviews Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and what was so awesome about it was, I have been working with a very like limited group of people on a project for like 6 years. And so it's always been the same faces, the same work styles. It's been fantastic, but it's been a long time. And I've been excited at the prospect of working with other people in our co-op and just having a different experience overall. So we put this out there. And because we're like a social justice-based, like systems change organization, a lot of people that come to us or that we reach out to work with us get excited because the thing they're doing doesn't always mean that they get attached to like social justice type work or change making work. And so that makes for a really cool relationship because it's people this happened with you, right? I remember you saying this, like you were like, hey, I'm happy to apply my skills to something about like juvenile justice and like helping kids or whatever. Like, so we got people like that. And we just, what was amazing is like almost everybody, even the people that were totally wrong for the job, they were all like inspiring to me. They all said something that I was like, oh my God, I've never thought about that way. And so it was lovely to see that there are people out in the world that think differently. There are that think like me, who I wouldn't have otherwise been able to connect with. And it made me really hopeful. Like there were people that aren't going to get this job that we're already going to be reaching out to about other work, you know? And so it just felt good. It just felt good to expand and remember, like, it's not just me in my tiny office. And I've been like that since way before the pandemic. It was cool. I don't want to work in offices with any of these people, but I'm like really excited to be kind of learning about like a way of thinking about work. And I think it'll solve, there are just natural conflicts that come up when you don't have a project manager. Like somebody will naturally sort of acquire or almost take a little more power than others. Some people who maybe think or talk differently or react differently, maybe they take more time to sort of gather their thoughts, end up being, sorted below the people that are really quick. And so for me, having a project manager is exciting because I think it can really, like, it can help us to kind of live out our, like, our equity goals, which we do a pretty good job of in our organization overall. We are just kind of we're a diverse organization, not in a forced way at all, but because we've just managed to kind of find our people. And so anyway, that just felt good. It felt good. I got excited about work and I've been pretty kind of like rote about work for a while. So that feels good. It was still hard to do all those interviews and get all my other deadlines met. So it caused a little stress too, but that was nice. And I'm really excited to be working with new people. So new spirits.
Nice. Now I'm worried that I might be one of those overly rigid copy editors.
Oh, you think so? No. Copy editing requires rigidity. You have to be a bit of a fascist. Like there's no way around that. Like, I want to be clear, like, it's a little tiny tripwire that you can hit, you know, and you have such a natural sense of voice anyhow.
Yeah.
That, and it's, but why do you think that? Why do you think maybe
So in my current job, for a while there, I was basically copy editing, and, we were using Markdown via a GitHub workflow for the editing, and I was very strict about like my like Markdown syntax and using GitHub properly, and like I'm good with, like, I understand voice, like if something was written, even if it's not a voice that I think is like perfect, I understand, like, this author has a voice and I can work with it. So I'm mostly focused on grammatical and spelling stuff when it came to the actual copy.
Yeah.
But as far as the tools went, I was a bit strict.
But don't you think that you're in a sort of programmer, you know, power user context, aren't you? So it feels like you should be able to get away with being strict about that.
I would think so.
Because I'll tell you what.
I got very frustrated.
Did you?
I did.
What was the thing that was most frustrating?
Just when basic Markdown syntax couldn't be adhered to. Like very syntactical things that didn't work. Like they were just wrong. And I repeatedly would fix them and add comments saying, please take care of this in the future. And like I have some niggles, like white space in Markdown documents, like always putting a line break before a list element,
yes,
or a line break after a headline, and things that just make readability of the Markdown itself easier, even though
super important,
you can get away with it in a lot of cases. You can get away with not doing it. Like, I set up a style guide and I was like, here are the rules, and repeatedly the rules weren't followed. And then I wrote some custom plugins and created my own syntax for a few things, and people never assimilated the information to make them work properly. So I spent a lot of time correcting liquid syntax, and I'm glad I'm past that part of my job.
Did you ever scream in a meeting? I am not. No, no, it's not. Did you ever scream in a meeting? Did you ever scream in a meeting? I am not a Linter.
I did not.
Episode title.
I did not. I would complain to Elle on our nightly walks. I would tell her how annoyed I was with, you know, an individual or my team in general. But I always maintained a very diplomatic persona in those yeah, proceedings.
Yeah.
I applied for a managerial position a little while ago, and I don't have a lot on my resume that is actual management positions.
Yeah.
But I have fallen into that role enough times that I feel like I could do the job.
Yeah.
Whether or not I actually want to is another question. But I feel like I make a good, I'm good at dealing with people and ordering people around without ordering people around. You know what I mean?
Right. Right.
Yeah.
Man, I don't do a lot of editing now, but I generally consider myself a good editor, not copy editor. I really love working with people's text. I love trying to sort of, I love making changes that they like. Sure. I don't mind it if they don't like it, but I would like to, what I want to be when I'm editing is someone who like is sensitive enough to the voice that I can take it on for a minute.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Not steal it, just take it on for a minute. I remember we used to, in the Punk Planet magazine days, our approach to interviews was we would take the full transcript. And I know there are people who are listening who are going to like slam their fists on the table, and you probably work in a newsroom, and that's why I don't work in newsrooms anymore. But we would take the entire Q&A and we would rewrite our questions if we needed to, because the absolute priority was readability. And what mm-hmm. we would hear over and over, I remember this happened with a Mekons interview that Dan, our the founder of Punk Planet, had done. John Langford was like, I've never sounded that articulate. Or like I actually learned something. I interviewed Ian MacKay of Fugazi, who sure. always seems to give a great interview, right? Like I don't know if you used to read interviews with him, but like if you're in punk rock, if you have a punk rock history, you've read some Ian MacKay interviews yeah. and you've appreciated the kind of nuggets. Well, I'm sorry, Ian, I'm sorry. I love you so much, but you were a fucking mess. And there was a point at which he was telling me about a game they play on tour where like you look at like a Ford Explorer or something like that, and you just add anal before it. So like anal explorer. And he went on about this for quite a while. This was an interview about digital music streaming and whether or not Discord would ever play ball with iTunes. That's how long ago it was, right? And I remember just being like, this is not how I imagined this would go. And so when I edited it, sure enough, like the quotes I pulled out were amazing. Like, and they were unedited. Like when he gets to his point, it's fantastic. Yeah. I don't mean to pick on Ian MacKay. I just feel like for all the years he spent yelling at people from the stage, I can like speak to him directly from my stage.
Yeah.
And I love you and you changed my life and all of that stuff. But anyway, like that's how we used to do interviews. And like, I brought that to editing in other contexts where it's like, where you actually are a little more allowed to do that, right? Like if it's yeah. someone's writing, you can kind of move things around. I loved that. I loved it. But that's all.
So like systematic, most of the interviews I've done in my life were for my old podcast, Systematic. And there were plenty of interviews over a few hundred episodes that definitely I would have liked to have the kind of liberties you can take in text.
Yeah.
You don't necessarily have, well, you can if you have the time in audio, but it pretty much, like, I could cut things out, but to, like, rearrange and, like, fill in quotes. You know how, like, in copy editing, you can write what someone said in quotes and then add, you know, in brackets or in between, you can kind of fill in and you can add sick.
Right. Yeah. Right. That's usually when I'm feeling like an asshole. Of.
or a note, an editor's note. And you don't get that. You don't have a lot of those liberties in an audio interview, which there were definitely cases where I would have appreciated that. But anyway.
Yeah, I love, I actually love editing audio. It is so incredibly time consuming. It's so fascinating to essentially edit text that you can't see.
Yeah.
And it's also amazing. When I was working in radio, this happened a lot when I was producing like 3-minute stories. It's like, you start to be able to kind of read the waveform, right?
Yeah.
Like, it's not like you know the words, but you can kind of, well, you could, some words you can start to recognize, like, right. Like, and, you know, everyone has their tick, but
yeah.
I find that kind of fascinating. Anyway, how about you? How about you? Let's, that's all.
Things are going really well on my current med regime. We've talked about, I believe, some of the problems I had with getting my Vyvanse. And
yeah,
I had gotten through most of the hoops through which I had to jump. Now that my psychiatrist has moved to a private practice, but they had a urine drug panel requirement. And I didn't know exactly what they were testing for, but I'm 90% drug free, except for some that I actually use for mental health,
right?
Which I'm not at liberty to talk about. But apparently, I'll just say psilocybin doesn't show up on a 10 panel urine test.
Interesting.
So that wasn't a concern for me, and everything else was going to be fine. But it took them like 2 weeks to get the results to my doctor. I had this, she went ahead and gave me like 2 weeks at a time until we had this figured out. But now everything is clear. I'm good to go. Future Vyvanse refills should not be nearly as much hassle as I went through to get set up with this new one. So that's good. One thing that I have found has been really good for me lately is hiking. We have this landmark in our town called Sugarloaf. It's a sandstone butte on top of.
Are there any bluegrass songs on Sugarloaf Mountain?
Oh, I'm sure we host a bluegrass festival. I'm sure it's been done. There's a newish trail that goes up to Sugarloaf, and it takes about 30 minutes, mostly uphill, to hike up the bluff up to Sugarloaf. You can like touch the rock and then head back down. So it's about an hour round trip. And I've been trying to do that once a week, and it has been really good for me. I'm building up cardio, endurance, and it's helping my mental health. And we're still going for walks in the refuge. So last week we did Sugarloaf on Sunday and then did the Wisconsin wetlands on Monday. And we saw 100 goslings. It was like they were probably 2 weeks old, most of them. So like the trails were just covered with like lines, like you'd have like the mom in the front and the dad in the back and like 6 to 8 goslings between them.
That's amazing.
And they would like cross the trail and hop in the water and like slowly escape from the invading humans. And we saw swans, and it was the, first dragonfly hatch
Oh, so nice. There,
yeah, like as you walk down the trail, like just dragonflies popping out of the trail, getting out of your way. And I'm looking forward to the damselfly hatch. I hope we catch that because like the sides of the trails turn blue with all of these damselflies.
Oh, my God. Wow.
And it's, yeah, it's really fun. I have a great time. So that was a very rewarding morning in the wetlands, and it stuck with me all week. And it is an experience like that, just getting out and seeing nature, like even aside from the mental health benefits of exercise, which are, you know, strong and well proven, but just seeing like natural phenomenon really sticks with me and gives me like a lot of pleasure through the whole week afterward. So that's been really good for me.
That's great. And I would say that 95% of our listeners probably have no idea how stunningly beautiful the part of Minnesota you are in is.
Yeah.
It's stunning. It's,
if you think of Minnesota and you think Iowa landscape, you haven't been to Southeast Minnesota, which is just all bluffs and valleys and green and so and rivers and lakes. And it's fantastic. Yeah.
It's truly incredible. I really should just come down to visit you. I don't know why I haven't done that yet.
You should. I just found out about a new 9-mile trail that I'm looking forward to checking out. But
nice.
So many good. We like the Holsinger Trail System is 9 miles of bluff trails. A lot open to mountain biking, but all open to hiking, and it's. It's fantastic. I'll show you around.
These mountain bikers are just insane. I don't understand how they aren't all dead. I want to know the mortality rate of mountain bikers that use those crazy trails.
Back in high school, I raced mountain bikes.
Did you?
And I would race all through Iowa, Wisconsin, Minnesota.
Dang.
And honestly, it was always great to come home because our trail systems are, we have, long uphill climbs with crazy downhill runs. And then most of the larger loops have something called suicide trails,
which good.
Like when you get to the peak, instead of taking the rounding, like kind of path down to the bottom, you can go straight down the hill, like straight down. And it is suicidal.
And is there some kind of emergency mental health provider at the top of the hill before you go down?
Negative. And
just a quick evaluation before you get down there.
And they're often in deep enough that you would have to get a helicopter if you had a serious injury. You'd have to be like airlifted out.
Yeah.
It's very dangerous. Yeah. But you know, at your own risk, I guess.
Yeah. You're immortal at that point. Definitely not at this point.
No, we got our bikes fixed up. Just spent $150 repairing bikes that had sat in storage for too long.
Wow.
Just yesterday, Elle and I started getting out for bike rides, and you can go 8 miles is too far for me to walk. I'm not going to do an 8-mile hike.
Yeah, no, me neither.
But an 8-mile bike ride, that's a different story.
That's a nice ride.
Yeah.
That's awesome. I think we should do a sponsor, but before we do that, I wanted to just let everybody know that we are going to a sort of reduced schedule for the summer. We're going to be going every other week starting today, starting with this episode. And then in August, we'll be launching season 4 of the Overtired podcast. Maybe we'll even have a new tagline.
Yeah.
Who knows?
Maybe who knows? Maybe something not Taylor Swift related.
Or maybe we'll all have Taylor Swift tattoos and it'll feel like, you know, let's just continue to merge with her.
We'll have some meetings. We'll confer.
Yeah, some meetings and confer. So what do you think? Good time for a sponsor?
Yeah.
All right.
So I actually, last time we did this sponsor, you weren't here and you were the one person that I thought would most appreciate this sponsor based on your feedback from the free samples they sent. So do you want to do this read?
Yes, I wish I still had I had saved the boxes of the ones I love the most, but I think I can speak to the quality of them. All right, so our sponsor this week is Factor. This spring, you need nutritious, convenient meat. Not just this spring, you always need nutritious, convenient meals to energize you for warmer, active days and keep you on track, reaching your goals. I find that trying to reach my goals usually means I'm not eating enough, but that's not the read. So Factor, America's number one ready-to-eat meal kit, can help you fuel up fast with ready-to-eat meals delivered straight to your door. You'll save time, eat well, and tackle everything on your to-do list. It's like the productivity spin, isn't it? Too busy to cook this spring with Factor? Skip the trip to the grocery store and skip the chopping, prepping, and cleaning up too. Factor's fresh, never frozen meals are ready in just 2 minutes. So all you have to do is heat and enjoy, then get back outside and soak up the warmer weather. They offer delicious, flavor-packed options on the menu each week to fit a variety of lifestyles, from keto, not keto like the great witness in the
no, the keto OJ system is in trial. Ketosis.
Ketosis. Hi, Factor. If you're paying attention to this read, I hope you understand this is value added. Okay, so skip the chopping, the prepping, the cleaning. They've got, you know, they can meet you where you're at, from keto to calorie smart, vegan and vegetarian and protein plus, prepared by chefs and approved by dietitians. Each meal has all of the ingredients you need to feel satisfied all day long while meeting your goals. With 34 plus chef prepared, dietitian approved weekly options, there's always something new to try. Plus, you can round out your meal and replenish your snack supply with an assortment of 45 plus add-ons, including breakfast items like egg bites, smoothies, and more. So you want to cut back on takeout? Get Factor instead. Not only is Factor cheaper than takeout, but meals are ready faster than restaurant delivery in just 2 minutes. With Factor, you can rest assured you're making a sustainable choice. They offset 100% of your delivery emissions to your door, source 100% renewable electricity for their production sites and offices, and feature sustainably sourced seafood in their meals. Head to factormeals.com/overtired50 and use code overtired50 to get 50% off your first box. That's code overtired50, and that's the number 50, not spelled out, at factormeals.com/overtired50 to get 50% off your first box. And I'll just say, we got a free box, and I was really surprised. Like, first of all, it was way less packaging than some of the other options I've noticed. But like, it tasted fresh and it was flavorful, and it had more than just two sort of layers of flavor, like microwave things often can.
Yeah. I've subscribed to meal plans because, like, the convenience of microwave meals can't be beat. Like, I appreciate meal kits that let me do some cooking, but that takes half an hour.
Right.
And part of the convenience of a meal plan is not having to spend so much time on food. So these microwave meals are great, but this is the first time I've ever had microwave meals that actually impressed me and didn't feel like a major compromise. They're delicious.
And like, also, it's pretty rare that you can satisfy all four members of our family, and this did. This is kind of separate from the read here, but just to say, like, my spouse and I have often joked, and it's not a joke, fucking dinner again? Like, seriously, this happens every day. So it's always something easy is always welcome. Anyway. That's that. Get your box of food, 50% off.
Separate from the read, I want to say, I don't know what Factor's employee treatment policy is. They're now owned by HelloFresh, which has done too much union busting for me to accept them as a sponsor. And I don't know if Factor is completely separate from that as far as their employee treatment goes. So if it comes to light that Factor is union busting, we will probably cease to have them as a sponsor and issue an apology. But for now, based on the research I've done, these guys are okay.
Despite making everything we's and not they's.
Yeah, right.
Ours and not theirs. There's some pronoun issues.
Yeah.
In this read. All right. Anyway. Okay. So I have a couple. I was rolling over cables on my floor. I have a couple of topics, I think. And I wanted to start with one. I got to thinking, as I often do, I sort of marvel at your cornucopia of skills. And as we've talked about on episodes before, the sort of graciousness of the tools you build. They I know that, you know, the ones that I use, which is most of them, really help me with my sense of just my sense of control. I can really just kind of lose a sense of centeredness when I'm working, especially if I'm working on projects with like three different clients in a day. And so Brett, your tools, or even just the philosophy of them, helped me a lot. So even if I've fallen off of the Terpstra wagon on some tool I used to use all the time, the sort of general philosophy behind it, it's just like, let's create order where there is chaos, not pretending that the chaos doesn't exist. That's actually a quality of your tools that I think is undersold. It accepts the chaos and tries to work on top of it, dance on the chaotic waters, if you will. Anyway, I'm going so far into this bit. I was wondering if you had one skill that you could kind of snap your fingers and then apply to the kind of work you've always been doing, what would it be?
Huh. Like a programming skill?
It could be a skill, or it could be like all of a sudden you are very good at thinking about and applying that thinking to, you know, whatever. Thinking about a thing.
Yeah. A thing that I would like to think more about would be future-proofing code. Mm. And I've gotten way better at it.
Mm.
I've gotten way better at writing code that other people can easily manipulate and contribute to.
Yeah, you're kind of defining now what future-proofing means, but go further into your definition of that.
Well, so writing maintainable code, I guess, is how I would phrase that. Writing code that a lot of the stuff that I've done has been based on APIs. Take Twitter, for example. Like a lot of the tools that I wrote around Twitter suddenly no longer work.
Yeah.
And writing code in a modular way that it's easy to say, substitute, Activity Pub or whatever Blue Skies API is called, to make it as modular as possible so that it can easily be transformed when something underlying breaks, or, you know, like a coding language like Ruby or Python goes through a major upgrade, make it code that's easy to retrofit into new requirements. And so, it's a talent I've been developing, but definitely one that I would like to, if I could just snap my fingers and be good at something, that's what I would like.
Okay, so then distinguish for me, I think, you know, we can all intuit what that looks like in terms of comments, you know, which I want to talk about in a minute, but like, I'm very interested in what that means in terms of writing the code itself. Like what are the qualities of code? You've said modularity is one,
yeah,
right? That is future proof.
It is. It's modularity. It's like when I first start working on something, I tend to write these long spaghetti scripts, like all in one file, not broken up well into functions. But by breaking it up into smaller methods and functions that can serve as like a single point of failure, means that you can just update one function and everything else will work, by properly reusing code and by making every action into a modular piece, then when something breaks, like say, for example, you have a function that performs an API call. If that API call is in the script itself and repeated multiple times, editing, if that API changes, editing becomes a hassle. Whereas if you call out to a single function that makes the API call and maybe takes parameters that can change what the API call is, then if something changes in the API, you can just edit that one function and everything continues working.
I would imagine too that taking that approach means that if somebody, let's say that there's a brand new language called Zool in 15 years, and somebody who's really good at Zool goes to look at your Ruby work and it's built exactly the way you've just described it, it must be easier to apply it to your own thing. Cause you're kind of going, I see he's doing this here and then this.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I've done some work lately translating Ruby into TypeScript. And definitely the more modular something is, the easier it is to grok exactly what's happening in a method and to rewrite it in a new language. And it would be nearly impossible to convert something that was just one huge function that did everything. And you have to convert it like line by line, but you don't know exactly how things relate to each other. And yeah, the more modular you can make it, the easier it is to translate between languages.
Okay, so then beyond comments, I'm wondering, so I think a lot about this with, we talked about it last week, like when you're using AI, like how do you denote that, right? And how do you denote it in a way that has the best chance of surviving into the future? But like, even separate than that, I've started to realize that, you know, with things moving so fast, like even as metadata, I would like to add a paragraph of context, you know? I was wondering in your case, like, is it useful to comment? Is it useful in the comments to say, hey, I made this thing to call this, you know, this particular API. This was this version of the API and it was done in this year.
Yeah, for sure.
This month of this year, you know?
I mean, that's usually discernible. Like a well-written API has its version number in the REST URL.
I was going to ask about that.
So it's usually pretty easy to discern. In cases where that's not true, absolutely. Denoting what version of the API you're using. Like that's, for me, like comments, you can explain literally everything that happens in a function. And if you use like ChatGPT to write your comments for you, it will explain everything the function is doing, and it will explain how each parameter is used, which is, I mean, thorough. But when I'm reading somebody else's code, I'm usually doing it with enough knowledge to glance at a block of code and understand what it's doing and how it's doing it. And the comments for me should just serve to, it should be like one or two lines that denote, here's what I did here. Maybe some comments within the function saying, you know, to do or fix me, or explaining why something is an unexpected way. I really like yard. I don't know if you're familiar with yard.
What's yard? Is it part of Zool?
It's a documentation syntax used, I think, only for Ruby, but it's a lot like JS doc or other. I'm sure there are things in Python that are similar, but you can write the comments out and then run a yard processing on it, and it turns it into documentation. So what you see is the name of the method, a description of what the method does, and then a description of every parameter it takes. And then it tells you what it returns, you know, an object or a hash or whatever.
I've often wondered with comments, like where, I'm sure everyone's different with this, but where do you draw the line between, okay, I am only going to address people who have a sort of implicit skill set that would cause them to be reading this code in the first place. Like,
yeah,
how do you think about that?
That's a good question. Like, in this age of AI that we are very suddenly in.
Very suddenly.
I don't think it's necessary to over document anything, because any coder, even if they're fresh to a language, can now ask ChatGPT to explain code to them.
Yeah.
And it will do that. And you could put that all in the comments. But I feel like, I don't know exactly where the line is, but there's a limit to how much is actually useful when someone could just select a code block and say, explain this to me.
Right. Right. That's true. Yeah. I think the only, and this hardly ever happens in comments, but it certainly does happen in comments. The only thing that you could add is voice.
Yeah.
Right. Like, which isn't necessarily that important, but it's like,
well, yeah. In code comments, you don't,
you don't have voice.
I find voice annoying.
Yeah. I do too. When I'm reading code, I don't, you know, but it's like, you know, if you really zoom in on a silicon chip, there's usually these little etchings that are like, there's Pac-Man, or it's like something silly that's way, way deep in there. That's fun, but that's different.
That's an Easter egg.
Most people just can't see that. Yeah, that's an Easter egg. Exactly. Okay, I have another related, like, what if you could question that's related to last week. I talked about being so happy to have found a Firefox extension that merges windows, because I spray tabs and windows indiscriminately into the crowd every day on my monitors. And I know with like Sublime Text, I've taken advantage for so long on being able to just merge all the tabs into one window. Cause I just like, for whatever reason, like if I'm in a big hurry, it's just straight to a text editor, even though I've got Envy Ultra running, that's where all my text, you know, that's where it all lives. But like, I just go to Sublime Text. So anyway, one of the kind of reasons that that's important is, you know, for me, we talked last week about how I need something that I can smash and everything goes back into some sort of order, right? So like, for me, it's being able to merge windows. There are, of course, all these like more nuanced things. Like I have Hazel working on a ton of desktop folders to make sure that my desktop is never totally insane. So there's things like that as well that are kind of running in the background. But there's this like thing that happens every day, which is my windows just build up and build up to the point where sometimes I kind of can't think. And I need to reset. I'm curious for you, Mr. Like, I've written a fucking hack for everything. Is there something that is common to how you use your computer right now that causes chaos that is as of yet unsolved?
I have a messy desk.
Yeah.
Like my physical desk is always a little bit messy. It gets cleaned maybe every other month. I'll do a full clean on it. But like I thrive with a certain amount of clutter.
Yeah.
And like right now, looking at my desktop.
Computer desktop.
I can see 12 different windows across two displays. And it doesn't bother me at all. Mm-hmm. Like using command tab switching and hiding and minimizing like makes that very manageable for me.
Yeah.
I do like to use Bunch when I'm switching to a new context that does not require all of the windows I currently have open. I'll just use Bunch and hide all. Or quit everything. Bunch has a command to literally quit every running app. Every running non-menu bar app.
The ultimate big red button.
You can just put burn everything into a Bunch file and it will quit everything and open like a new workspace for you.
Yeah.
I don't have any friction in the way I'm working right now. I like being able to, like, a lot of times I'll be working in two apps at once, or two windows at once. And I have keyboard shortcuts that will move windows to left and right sides of the screen.
Sure.
Or like I have a keyboard shortcut when I'm working in Sublime or multi Markdown Composer, I can just hit hyper mod K, which is the same as hyper down arrow.
Yeah.
And it will center it'll narrow the window to like 800 pixel width and center it on the screen full height. And like that's how I like to edit text. And like keyboard shortcuts that move my windows around and arrange everything, and I can pretty much navigate entirely using my keyboard, and I'm pretty happy with it. I don't have any problems that are nagging me.
Yeah. I'm still in a situation where, partly again, because I work on different projects with different clients, there's like different ways of communicating. There are different ways of storing the project data. One way I kind of control all of that right now is my Stream Deck always has, like, we use Google Drive a lot, which I do not love, but we use it all the time. And there are things I like about it, but overall, I don't love it. But how else are you going to do this collaboratively, right? So I have buttons for like all of the major folders.
Yeah.
That's mostly because where I have this kind of quality, or this, let's just call it a problem, where if I'm in a meeting, it's very difficult for me to navigate things on my computer while I'm in the context of a meeting. I get sort of, I'm almost like rattled if I try. It's kind of, I have this problem when I'm driving, where if I'm driving alone or with somebody who's quiet, I'm fine. If I'm driving and talking, I'll miss every single fucking turn. I'll randomly turn right. Like all kinds of things go wrong. And it's similar.
You're not a multitasker. Most people aren't.
No. I accept that, right? Like that's like scientifically supported.
Yeah.
It's not a thing that is actually what we think it is. But anyway, for me, having these physical buttons on the Stream Deck so that when I'm in a conversation with somebody, I know I can quickly pull up these folders and then help answer the question. There's something in me that it definitely lived in me in school, where I was constantly terrified of being put on the spot. Whereas I'm really super comfortable sort of in a truly collaborative conversation. But if I think I'm going to be put on the spot, I'm like hot faced from the start. Right.
Yeah.
So this kind of helps me to just pull shit up. I need it so bad. And likewise, the thing that I've really, not dedicated enough time to, I need information at my hands. And so I don't have enough in, say, Envy Ultra, to be able to really quickly call up information. And my goal would be to have all of my 8 million notes I've made in Sublime, that are saved in like project folders, to have them all be like well-organized notes in Envy Ultra so that I can just pull information up quickly. Cause I really, I panic in context. Like if I'm in the middle of a meeting, I just can't do it.
So in a similar vein, like the one thing I have on my Stream Deck that's related is I have a button that raises up the Zoom meeting.
Yes.
So I can go off. It's like a panic button almost. So like while someone's talking, I can go check something on my machine. I can load up whatever app is necessary to follow up on what's happening in the meeting. And then with one button, I can bring the now obscured Zoom window back to the foreground.
Yeah.
See whatever's being shared or everything. I hate when screen sharing starts and it goes full screen.
Yeah. That, I hate that.
That messes with me. So I immediately will always move it back to a regular window.
I think you can set it to not do that, but I've never done it.
Yeah, I've never figured that out either. But with one button, then I can get back and see what people are saying, what's happening. And then I have buttons for mute and unmute.
Yeah.
And start and stop video, because I really appreciate at Oracle how it's been normalized to show up for meetings without video.
Oh, that's wonderful.
It is. It is. It's great. And like if I'm in a one-on-one meeting and the person I'm talking to turns on their camera, I will also, just because it feels like
it's a norm.
A mutual thing.
Yeah.
But in most meetings, I don't have a camera on. If a personal question is asked that I feel like deserves a video response, I have a button that'll turn that on for me.
And that's a nice idea.
Off later.
That's a nice idea.
So have you played around with Hookmark?
So yes, and not since it became, I played around with it when it was called what? Hook. And here's the thing. When I play with a tool like that, I can immediately see that I am not going to go all the way in, which means I'm going to have all this fucking cruft everywhere, I think. I don't know if there's literally cruft left behind. But since it became hook mark and it showed up in my set app, and I feel like maybe it's going to be around, I've been meaning to play with it. So tell me why you brought it up.
Well, so when you talk about having a bunch of notes in Sublime, like hook mark makes it possible to organize and search documents in disparate places.
Yeah.
Like I like NV Ultra for all of my notes. Yep. And it, like, the full text search makes, I've never had to take more than 5 keystrokes to get to what I'm looking for. But
yeah.
I also have notes in PDF files. I have notes in Quip documents. I have notes in, you know, wherever. And with Hookmark, I can correlate. Like I'll have a project where it has a task paper file in my GitHub repository, and I will just hookmark. I will hook that task paper file to all of the related notes, whether it's a mind map, whether it's an NV Ultra note, whether it's a document somewhere else on the system. And from any of those connected documents, I can then just load up Hookmark and flip to any other linked document. And it takes a little, there's a level of effort involved. You have to link things that you know you're going to want to switch between in the future. It's not like tagging, where you can just tag something with a common tag and then be able to find it in Finder search,
right,
or with WhoTaSpot or whatever. You have to create very intentional links between items.
So I have a question. Well, first question is a really important, obvious one, which is, do the links to these files follow the files through the system if you move them around? And then, okay, I figured so.
I think they refer to them as sturdy links.
Oh, sturdy. You know what? That's a sturdy link.
So macOS offers this thing called bookmarks. Not to the average user, but every file on the system has a kind of a digital footprint that you can change the name of the file, and the bookmark doesn't change. It represents a file system object it doesn't matter where it's located. It doesn't matter what it's named. The bookmark will always find it. And I believe that's what Hookmark uses to make these 30.
I was going to ask you, what does this look like behind the link?
Yeah.
Okay.
So Hookmark can also work with any app that offers an Apple script or URL handler way to access a deep link, meaning, like, sure, you can open the document, you can open a PDF, but what if you had a particular note in the PDF you wanted to be able to access?
Yeah.
Or like a specific paragraph. And so a deep link would take you straight to that paragraph.
Got it.
Those don't have file system bookmarks the way that a file would. The file itself can, but it's dependent on the application to be able to read exactly where it wants to go. And like Hookmark is compatible with a ton of, like, PDF viewers, for example. I can't remember. I don't do a lot of deep linking in PDF, so I don't remember exactly what apps are compatible with it. But for researchers that use PDFs constantly and want to get to highlighted notes and stuff, Hookmark integrates with some very specific apps in ways that aren't necessarily file OS dependent, but they are app dependent.
So in the case of deep links, that's not something that Apple provides any access to. That's something a programmer has to decide to add into their app.
Right.
Interesting. And okay, so one final question about Hookmark is actually about this bookmark thing you were just talking about. How can you see those? I mean, how can I, if I wanted to see what that file looks like and where those bookmarks are, what would be my pathway to seeing it?
So I published a tool called...
It's always the answer. I published a tool called...
it's called Bookmark. I can't remember if it's easily accessible on my blog or not. I'll find a link for the show notes. But really, like, this is accessible through Objective-C and Swift. It's not something that is exposed to any of the standard interface.
It's not search link.
No.
That's what comes up when I search Terpstra bookmark.
No, it's literally, it's a compiled program. Bookmark on my site. Oh, wait. I'll see if I can find you a link real quick. Edit. Yeah, no. Oh, bookmark CLI. Here it is. Dropping it into, we'll put it in Slack and you can see what I'm talking about.
Awesome.
Jeff.
That's me.
Yeah. So it, like, this tool I wrote basically uses Objective-C to expose the bookmark data for a file, and it outputs it as a reasonable length base64 kind of fingerprint.
Got it.
And it can read those and write those, so you can use it in scripts to follow a bookmark for a file instead of hard coding the path to a file.
Yeah.
You can record its bookmark and access it again using that, no matter where the file moves to on the system.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Even though this was kind of its own deep Grapptitude, before we get to official Grapptitude, because it's getting about that time,
yeah.
I just wanted to say, if I could snap my fingers and have any ability, it would be the ability to make space in a professional context, to make space when there's a new tool I see and I really want to play with it enough to be able to think about it, to be able to just make that space and not have it interrupt flows that are supposed to end in deadlines. I was talking to a friend who is an artist who makes these things called breathers, Paul Chan. And they're basically, if you think of the like wavy hand things at the car lot, he kind of figured a way to make these into things that actually elicit other emotions besides just joy.
Sure.
And whimsy. And doing that, and if anybody's in Minnesota, he's got a whole bunch of these at the Walker right now. Doing that, sometimes just one piece. He spent 89 weeks sewing, breaking down. And an artist can do that when they're successful and they make enough money that they can just decide to do that. And he's in that wonderful place. But I wish there was a way in the manic world of knowledge work to find time that isn't just that, not late at night when you can otherwise be hanging out with your friends or family, but in the course of the day to just make that spaciousness. Cause boy, I got a long list of how I'd use that, which then of course creates its own lack of spaciousness.
Sure.
It's all the way down. But shall we Grapptitude?
Yeah, let's do it. Do you want me to go first?
Yeah, go ahead.
All right. I'm picking Kaleidoscope this week. We may have picked it before, but they just came out with version 4. They had previously implemented a subscription price that, while I thought they deserved it, I didn't think it was commercially viable.
A lot of money, like $125 or something like that.
Yeah, like the yearly cost.
I paid it.
Quickly added up. Their new price is $8 a month if you pay yearly, which to me, for what they're offering, is a good sustainable deal. And the new version does syntax highlighting of most coding languages. And it adds this menu bar. Let me rewind. Kaleidoscope is a diff program. Mm-hmm. It gives you a graphical interface to diffs, changes between two versions of a file. It works great with Git for comparing change sets, for doing merges. If you have a merge conflict, I don't mess around with raw files or with cherry picking. I just run Git merge tool, and it opens the conflicts for me in Kaleidoscope. And I can just use keyboard nice. Shortcuts to navigate through and pick, do I want the original or the modified or like my local version? And I merge them, save, hit save, and go back to Git and commit the changes, and everything works. It gives you, it's a great looking app.
So good. It makes diffs mesmerizing.
Yeah, for sure. And you can view diffs as side by side, unified, or with, I don't know what it's called, when you have, it's like a map and it has like arrows between, or like lines two diffs. I don't know what that's called, but the newest version adds a menu bar item called Kaleidoscope Prism, and you can use that to diff clipboard objects. You can drag multiple files to it, and it runs even when Kaleidoscope isn't running. One feature they added was the ability to save a change set, to save like a comparison as a new file, allowing direct editing. And I had to email them because I'm like, can you explain to me how this works in your workflow? Like, under what circumstances is this important? So I'm waiting for an email back from them on that before I write a review for my blog.
Oh, nice.
Because it seems like a very cool feature that should be important. I just don't yet understand how it would fit into my workflow. Like, what do I do that could be easier if I could save and edit a merge file, I guess they call
That's what I do with spaciousness. It's exactly the kind of shit I would do with spaciousness.
So anyway, if you're a coder, it can also do image comparisons. So you can see exactly what changed between two versions of an image. And folder comparisons, which I find very handy if, like, for my all of my fish functions.
Yeah.
I edit locally and then will publish the pertinent ones to GitHub. So I use Kaleidoscope's folder comparison to compare my GitHub folder with my local folder, and then I can just click on the files that I actually want to show up in
GitHub. I have not used it for that. That's great.
Yeah, it's cool. So that's my pick for the week.
If we've got your ear at the moment, Kaleidoscope, the thing that I would love, and I'm sure it's a whole thing or it would be there, is audio diffs. just, you know, like a 3-minute, you know, clip. You've got the waveform. You've edited a little bit. Show me how it's different. Show me what I cut out.
Or video while you're at it. Like,
yeah,
I was watching a video on, it was a reaction to a particular hardcore creationist, and it showed how they were editing when they published their version of an interview or a debate, where they were editing the video. Because like this example, the debate itself in its full form was like an hour and a half. And what the creationist published was like 20 minutes that made him look like he won the debate.
Yeah.
And they showed a frame, like a, what would you call it? A timeline.
Yeah.
of the two versions with big red blocks.
That's awesome.
Where stuff was edited out. So that
this was like a visualization they created. Yeah. It wasn't necessarily automatically generated, right?
Yeah.
Got it.
Okay. Well, I mean, I don't know if there's a tool that does this. Like, it seems like it would be.
There must be a tool that does this. We'll do our homework.
There must be. It would be such a huge manual process to go through and like figure out exactly where something was edited. But
completely. I guess the last thing I'd say about Kaleidoscope is it's an app like Name Mangler, which I love, which is also beautifully designed, where these are things you can do programmatically for the most part.
Yeah.
But they make it not just user-friendly, but like beautiful, so that even, it sounds like from you, Brett, like even people who are perfectly capable of doing this without Kaleidoscope choose Kaleidoscope.
Yeah.
Because it's stunning.
Absolutely.
And it's very clear. Very, very clear. It's just a wonderful.
And there are free merge and diff tools. Delta, I can't even remember. Like I'm out of the game because Kaleidoscope stole my heart.
Mine is actually just a way that I'm using Bunch this weekend as I find little bits of time. So this is related to me talking about things getting chaotic and wanting to have a big red button. One specific way things got chaotic for me last week is I had an incredibly overscheduled week that involved, you know, interviewing candidates for this project manager job and doing interviews for a project I'm on and all this stuff. And I don't know what happened, but twice this week under different circumstances, one my fault, one not, I was scheduled to interview a group of people and I only knew that I was the one on that interview because I'm sharing it with a colleague because I got that email from Zoom that said, so-and-so has joined your Zoom room, which is a fucking nightmare if you don't know what that's about.
Yeah, for sure.
And so I'm writing a bunch. It happened twice, right? Like that's the other thing. It's like, I feel like it's really important. Like if something happens twice, just try to take 10 minutes and automate that shit. So it happened twice. And so what I'm writing is a bunch that really pulls up the script, the protocol for that particular project, gets me in my Zoom room as quickly as possible without video. There was one where I was throwing on a shirt, putting on a button down shirt just before I got there. But just gets me set up and has everything in front of me. And actually, if that's the case, I can just pick right up. It's not a big deal. Like if I only have 2 seconds to prepare, but everything's in front of me, that's okay.
Yeah.
It's when I start and I'm not prepared that I'm screwed.
Yeah.
So that's a use for bunch. That's my gratitude. Thanks, Brett.
You're welcome. I haven't added much to bunch for a while now.
Well, you added enough over the course of like a year.
That was the result of many manic episodes.
Right.
But now I've been stable for long enough that I've been able to correct some bugs. I've done some bug fixing and I added support for the Arc browser was like the last.
Oh, nice.
Last update.
Well, but given the connection to manic episodes, I hope for absolutely no updates to Bunch. Users out there, if you care about Brett, just let him know. You're not looking for an update. Don't tell him you are looking for an update.
My psychiatrist and I and my therapist are all in agreement that the occasional manic episode is productive for me.
Yeah.
And that I don't really want to live life with zero manic episodes.
Yeah.
But like monthly manic episodes is a bit much to handle. And like constantly ping ponging between mania and depression.
Yeah. That's
is less productive than just being stable. So we're finding our balance, but
yeah. Yeah, I'm glad. I'm so glad. That's really, that's been a big change over the arc of the time that I've been on this podcast and that I've known you.
Yeah. Yeah. It's definitely a constant kind of struggle for me to like find a balance.
Yeah. Yeah. I know one way that helps.
Get some sleep, Jeff.
The system is going down now.